There's going to be some fire later. We're gonna need it to separate the iPhone Air's titanium exoskeleton from the frame. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. Rumor has it that for the first time, Apple is using 3D printed titanium near the charging port. I've previously said that Apple doesn't innovate, but this iPhone Air durability test and teardown has proven me wrong several times over. Tim Cook has absolutely been cooking. To get inside this time around, let me first introduce the greatest crossover in history, the new Jerry-Rig Everything Portable iFixit Toolkit, which has a lifetime warranty. This guy's got all the bits you need to work on everything from iPhones to Nintendos to your grandma's glasses, and every kit includes one of my classic Jerry-Rig razor knives. It's also got a solid anodized aluminum driver, 32 precision bits, and of course a beautiful selection of pry tools. If any of your bits ever break, we will replace it. That warranty, of course, does not extend to your fingers. Steve Jobs might have not approved of repairing your own stuff, but we know that when you do it yourself, 60% of the time it works every time. Grab your pre-order in the description, and we'll start shipping these toolkits on December 10th, just in time for Christmas. Lucky for us, some of the opening of the iPhone Air's back glass occurred during my bend test, and while I wish I was an air bender, it actually withstood all of my attempts at bending, and only gave up the ghost after 216 pounds worth of pressure was applied with an engine hoist, snapping it in half. It's a ridiculously strong phone, but thanks to that engine hoist and a little bit of heat from my heat gun, and the removal of two pentalobe screws at the bottom, we get our first look at the insides. And this might come as a surprise, but the iPhone Air is in fact not made of air. The wrinkly battery has seen better days, but the new metal battery enclosure Apple is using probably helped the Air survive as long as it did. With the wireless charger unscrewed and unclipped from the motherboard, it's nice to see how easy to swap the back glass is now. Huge thumbs up for that. The back glass still has the wireless charging magnets installed. These are 100% recycled, which is also pretty awesome. The copper coils on the back of the iPhone Air are also made from 100% recycled copper, and in my opinion, should be 100% visible from the back of the phone. I'm not sure why they always hide this stuff away on the inside. Speaking of recycled, 95% of the lithium in this battery comes from recycled sources, along with 100% of the cobalt and 80% of the steel enclosure, which needs to be unplugged very quickly. The screen of the iPhone Air is also pretty easy to remove and replace. Normally I'd use a suction cup and some heat while dripping in some isopropyl, but today we're performing more of an autopsy than a repair and I'll just peel it off. There is a hefty amount of adhesive around the edges, probably to help with that IP68 waterproof rating. There's one additional tri-point screw and two ribbons holding the screen to the body. A technician could probably swap out a broken iPhone Air screen in about 5 minutes, if they really wanted to. I'm a fan of this design. The iPhone Air is actually pretty repairable. That's the last joke, I promise. We'll get to the sensor shift in the main camera unit here in a second, along with the single speaker, single vibrator, and the 3D printed titanium USB-C port, after we get this battery out. Bent batteries can blow up at any time. To remove the battery, we need another battery. And while I do applaud Apple for having a removable battery system, using electrically releasing adhesive is a bit of a hassle. I think Samsung still does it better with their pull tabs. There are two positive flaps on either side that need to be electrocuted individually. Adhesive isn't really rocket science, at least not for inside of a smartphone, and short-circuiting a strip of adherent for 90 seconds on each side, while effective, seems a little excessive. I do appreciate how zero force is needed though to get the battery out, and maybe that's worth the slightly more complex removal procedure, but let me know what you think down in the comments. The metal enclosed iPhone Air battery is 3,149 mAh, and interestingly enough, iFixit has found that the exact same battery is used in the iPhone Air's wireless battery pack, which is a super smart way to optimize the supply chain. Why make two different batteries when you only need one? And you might be asking, hey Jerry, if they're the same size, why does the wireless charger only give the iPhone Air 65 percentage points worth of additional charge? And I'm glad you asked. That just shows how inefficient wireless charging actually is. 35% just kinda gets lost in the ether. Making our way up to the singular non-stereo loudspeaker, it's on the opposite side of the singular camera unit. And at first glance, there does not appear to be any balls inside, which is brave of Apple. The Air only has one speaker. So that one speaker needs to sound really good. The little gold springs rest up against the motherboard to receive its communication. However, if I grab some needle-nose pliers and snip the loudspeaker right down the center, it turns out the iPhone Air does have balls inside, and that single speaker will indeed sound as good as a single speaker can sound. Nice. One of my favorite innovations Apple has brought to the smartphone world has to do with the optical image stabilization. It's not new, right? Apple's been doing it since the iPhone 12 Pro, but instead of mechanically moving the lens of the camera unit to stabilize video or pictures, Apple is shifting the sensor. This allows for more precise and reactive stabilization since the sensor is lighter than the lens barrel and can be more rapidly and accurately adjusted, up to 5,000 times a second, 5 times faster than the traditional lens-shifted OIS found in every other smartphone. The sensor kind of floats, suspended on a spring of copper strands, while the coils in the corners interact with the magnets in the upper half to make those sensor adjustments. It's really nifty stuff. Larger premium DSLR cameras have been doing this for a while, but Apple is the first one to miniaturize the technology and stick sensor shifting into a smartphone. So while indeed the iPhone Air only has one 48 megapixel camera, that one camera has some rather premium internals. Busting out our fourth screwdriver bit for the motherboard standoff screws, Apple kinda throws different sizes and shapes of screws in here willy-nilly, we have a few more Lego-style ribbon connectors that also need to be unplugged, and finally, the motherboard is released. This has the new A19 chip inside, and it's kinda wild that the entire brain for the iPhone Air sits inside this tiny little hunk of circuitry. 100% of the gold and tin in this board has been recycled, but there is no thermal paste or cooling system. Apple added a new square sensor to the front-facing 8-megapixel center stage camera, so I'll pop off that sensor. It's tied to the same unit as the Face ID scanners, and while I did kinda crush out the glass, the sensor itself is indeed square. Or it was square. Now I have more blue crystal on my desk than Walter White. Don't do it! Before we can get a microscopic look at the 3D printed titanium, that vibrator needs to come out. Rumor is that this vibrator isn't quite as strong as on the iPhone 17 Pro, but I do have a full dedicated vibrator review video coming out soon, and we'll find out for sure how these things work. Hit that subscribe button so you don't miss it. Now, the charging port is probably the least repairable part of the iPhone Air. There are at least 13 different size screws down here, in all kinds of weird perpendicular places. So if anyone asks you to repair the charging port on this thing, just say no. The rest of the phone is great, but for some reason, Apple can't figure out how to consolidate this specific component. It's been chaos since the iPhone 4. With all the screws gone, I can pull the USB-C port away from the USB-C housing, and you can see the little black gasket that waterproofs the union. The ribbon snakes all the way up to the motherboard, but now that I look at it, maybe I didn't need to remove all those screws after all, and I could have gotten away with just removing the two perpendicular ones. Maybe Apple has had a change of heart, or maybe I did something wrong. We'll never know. Either way, this cute little part isn't the part that's 3D printed in titanium. If we take a really close look, the 3D printed titanium is found in the USB-C housing. Samsung, on their ultra-thin phone, just milled a slot into the edge of the S25 Edge. Apple here has chosen to use a separate procedure made entirely with 3D printed titanium. I don't think it's 3D printed in the sense that they have a roll of titanium filament extruded out a hot end. I imagine it's more of an SLM or selective laser melting process. Still additive, of course, but it involves firing a laser into titanium dust to fuse layers of the powder together to create more complex and intricate parts. You can see the layers of titanium buildup here in this port. Apple uses 100% recycled titanium for this part. And they say this printing procedure uses 33% less material than forging. They could also be using a binder jetting process, but either way, it's definitely not 3D printed conventionally. Apple says their new Apple Watch is also entirely 3D printed in titanium, so let me know down in the comments if you want to take a microscopic look at that one as well. Finally, we get to the bare frame of the iPhone Air. Apple let the cat out of the bag when they said the iPhone Air has a 100% recycled aluminum on the interior structural portion, which means, just like the other previous titanium iPhones, the titanium is only on the exterior skeleton. Still, obviously, providing a massive amount of strength through the thin walls, but if we torch the titanium, we should be able to melt or burn away any of the other layers. While leaving the premium exoskeleton intact. And look at that. I can chip off the crusty slag and reveal just the titanium that's been left behind. Not a bad thing, obviously, to have an exoskeleton. Samsung built their titanium phones in the exact same way, and it's obviously still stronger than me. If you want to see the insides of your own phone, without the chaos of actually taking it apart, I highly recommend snagging one of my teardown skins from dbrand. You can see all the sensor shift hardware along with the wireless charging magnets, and of course the vibrator down in the corner, which is just a preview. And of course, if you want to become the ultimate handyman that your mom thinks you are, I'll leave a link for my new toolkit down below as well. Thanks a ton for watching. I'll see you around.